हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू JCE कनेक्ट। सब्जेक्ट इंजीनियरिंग जियोलॉजी, 18 CV 36। सो वी हैव स्टार्टेड विद द फिजिकल प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ मिनरल्स। इन द प्रीवियस क्लासेस वी हैव डिस्कस्ड द लाइट डिपेंडेंट प्रॉपर्टीज, दैट इज द कलर, स्ट्रीक, लस्टर एंड डायफिनिटी। Now we'll move on to the next property of the mineral, the physical property, that is specific gravity. So specific gravity, it is the ratio of mass of the substance or a mineral to the mass of equal volume of water. So here, what is the definition of specific gravity? Mass of the mineral or any substance in the air to the equal volume of water, that is called as the specific gravity. So the formula is mass or weight in air divided by weight in air minus weight in water. So that will give you the specific gravity of a mineral. So suppose if a mineral is having specific gravity 4, what it means? It means it is 4 times heavier than water. So it is 4 times heavier than water. So each mineral will have a different specific gravities. Then how do we determine the specific gravity of a mineral? So there are different instruments which are used to determine the specific gravity of a mineral. So one is Walker-Stiliard balance and another one is Joly's spring balance. So here we'll discuss only one, that is Walker-Stiliard balance, how it works to identify or to know how the specific gravity of a mineral is determined. So this is how the Walker-Stiliard balance looks. So this is an instrument which consists of a graduated horizontal beam. You can see here, this is the horizontal beam which is graduated, means numbered, okay. So and it is pivoted near this end, okay, so that it moves, and a movable weight is attached to the shorter arm of this. So here there will be a heavy weight, okay, which you can rotate, okay, and this is used to balance the this graduated beam. Okay, so this the specimen of which we want to determine the specific gravity, that specimen is which is under study, that is tied with the silk thread and it is attached to the beam with a hook which is provided. So on the larger arm, that is on this, okay, arm, the mineral of which we want to determine the specific gravity, that is this one, that is attached using a string or a thread. Okay, then once you attach this, okay, what happens? This beam starts oscillating. Okay, why? Because we are adding weight on it, right? So it starts oscillating. So now what we have to do is we have to balance this till the beam becomes horizontal. So how do we do it? So we have to rotate this balance or the counterbalance, that is a heavy weight which is attached. So as you start moving this weight, okay, the beam starts becoming horizontal. Simultaneously you can move the mineral also, okay, so till it becomes the horizontal. So that is the first step. What we have to do, the mineral, we have to attach it to the horizontal beam, and till it becomes horizontal we have to adjust mineral as well as the counterbalance. Okay, then once this beam becomes horizontal, you have to note down this particular reading, that is the A reading, that is what, the weight of the mineral in air. Okay, then next we have to find out the weight of the mineral in water. So what we have to do, same mineral, we have to immerse it into a beaker which is full of water. Okay, so there is a water in the beaker. Okay, then What happens when you immerse the mineral into the water? The again beam starts oscillating. So what we can call the weight of the mineral in air, we'll call it as a. Okay, so A is what? Weight of the mineral in air. So then same specimen, what we have done now, we have immersed into a beaker which is full of water. So this will disturb the balance again. So then to again make this beam horizontal, what we have to do? The specimen is moved along the beam until this beam becomes horizontal. Now we should not move this counterbalance. Only we have to move the mineral till it becomes horizontal. Okay, so when you come here, it has become balanced. So this specimen is under water and the beam is horizontal. So here we'll note down this reading. Okay, that is the weight of the mineral in water, that is B. Okay, so A is what? Weight of the mineral in air, and B is weight of the mineral in water. Now the formula to find out the specific gravity is B upon B minus A. This is the formula to find out the specific gravity of a mineral. Okay, so specific gravity is equal to what? Weight of the mineral in water divided by water minus air. That is the specific gravity, how we determine for a particular mineral which is under observation. Now we'll move on to the next property of the mineral. So this is the next property is hardness. So what is a hardness? Hardness is defined as the mineral's resistance to scratching or abrasion. Means what? It is the again most diagnostic property of a mineral. So it is defined as degree of resistance, you can call. Okay, or degree of resistance of a mineral to abrasion or scratching. That is called as the hardness. So minerals with high number will scratch the number below them on the scale. So there is a scale which will be used as a standard scale. That scale is called as the Mohs scale of hardness. So what is this Mohs scale of hardness? So in this scale there are 10 minerals which are arranged in their increasing order of the hardness. So the first one is the softest mineral whose hardness is 1. The name of the mineral is talc. And the last one, the hardest mineral, I hope everyone knows, that is a diamond whose hardness is 10. So these are the minerals which you need to remember in order. Okay, so the first mineral is talc whose hardness is 1. Second is gypsum. Okay, then third is calcite, then fluorite, apatite, orthoclase, quartz, topaz, corundum, and the last one is diamond. So this is the Mohs scale of hardness. So it is determined, so how to determine the hardness of a mineral? So to determine hardness, what we have to do, we have a 10 minerals, okay, a set of 10 minerals with known hardness. Okay, then what you have to do, you have to take a mineral whose hardness you want to find out, and you have to go on scratching the mineral from the hardness box, okay, one by one. Okay, then if it gets scratched, if your sample gets scratched by the hardness, suppose third hardness, that is calcite, if you have taken and scratch it on the specimen, that means what? If the scratches come on it, then its hardness is 3. If the noise comes, okay, then it is said that its hardness is 3. Otherwise, what will happen if it is, if you have taken the first mineral and you have rubbed it on the specimen of no unknown hardness, then this mineral, that is talc, will get powdered on this. Okay, you can see the powder of talc on the specimen. Then what it indicates? It's the specimen has hardness more than one, right? Then similarly, you will take the second mineral, that is gypsum, and you will rub it on it. Again, gypsum is getting powdered, but not this specimen is not getting the scratches. So this indicates the hardness is 2. Like that, you have to go on checking with all the minerals, and once the powder will not come, okay, noise will come, noise is produced, then you can say that the particular mineral has the particular hardness. So softer minerals, they produce much powder and little noise, okay, while the harder minerals, they produce the less powder and greater noise. Okay, so a series of 10 minerals, okay, with the known hardness, they are called as Mohs scale of hardness. So this is a standard set of minerals, okay, which is used to determine the hardness of a unknown mineral. So in this hardness box, okay, the first two minerals, that is the talc and gypsum, you can scratch it with even your fingernail, okay, that means your fingernail has hardness more than 2, because you can scratch the mineral 1 and 2 with the fingernail. Then the hardness 3, 4, and 5, okay, that is calcite, fluorite and apatite, they can be scratched by knife, okay. And the next one, that is orthoclase and quartz, they are scratched by, we need to take efforts, they are scarcely scratched by knife, okay. And the last two, they cannot be, last three, they are harder. So topaz, corundum and diamond, they are more harder, so they cannot be scratched by knife. So here one thing we need to understand, that the harder mineral, especially from 7, 8, 9, 10, that is quartz, topaz, corundum and diamond, they are used as gemstones because they are harder, okay, they run for a longer time, okay, the chances of getting damaged are very less, so the hardness is more. Because of this reason, these minerals are used as gemstones, whereas these minerals, they are softer. Why they are softer? Because they have one particular property called cleavages. So I'll tell you what is cleavage, okay. So cleavage is breaking, okay, breaking of a mineral. So types of cleavage and all we will discuss. So here just remember that these minerals are soft, these are weak because they have cleavage, so they are not used as gemstones, but these minerals, they are used as gemstones. So this is the one more property called hardness of a mineral. So hardness is determined by Mohs scale of hardness. Next, we'll see what is mean by cleavage. So cleavage is what? The cleavage is the tendency of a mineral to break along a definite direction, yielding a plane surface. That is called as a cleavage. So here the figure will give you a clear idea. Okay. So here in the first figure, there is a mica mineral. Wait. Okay. So this is a mica. Okay, which is foliated or layered. You can see here the layers. So why that mineral splits into layers? Because it has one set of cleavage. Cleavage means what? It is breaking of a mineral along a definite direction, and that will yield a definite or a plane surface. Okay, so that is called as the cleavage of a mineral. So muscovite has one set of cleavages, we call it as a basal cleavage. Okay, then if you take feldspar, okay, it will have cleavages in two directions, okay, one is like this and other one is like this. So that is a feldspar which has a cleavage in two directions, okay, so two set of cleavages. Then the mineral called halite, which has a three set of cleavages, and we call it as a cubic cleavage. You can see here perfect cubes, okay, this also shows it is a perfect cube. Okay, so why it is breaking in a perfect cubic form? Because it has the cubic cleavage, means it has a plane along which it will break in three directions. So here in the three colors it is shown, it is easy to understand, right? One is the white color plane, okay, which is vertical. One more which is shown in green color, and one more which is yellow, that is horizontal. Okay, so it has three set of cleavages. Similarly, calcite also has the cleavages in three directions, but its special character is its cleavages are rhombic. Okay, rhomb means like this, shankarpadi. Okay, so rhombic is the cleavage of a particular mineral called calcite. So calcite has rhombic cleavage. So whenever you take a calcite mineral in hand, okay, and if you try to break it, it will always break in a rhombic fashion. Similarly, if you take halite, it will always break in a cubic fashion, because it has the cleavages, cubic cleavage or rhombic cleavages. Okay, so that is the particular property of a mineral. So here in the image I have shown again three minerals. First is fluorite, and then this is halite, which is having cubic cleavages. Okay, and this is calcite, which has cleavages, that is rhombic cleavage. Okay, so it is the characteristic of some minerals to break into flat sheet or along a certain plane. So why these mineral will break in that particular fashion? Because along these planes, what happens, the bonding between the atoms will be weak, and that is the reason why these minerals break in a particular direction. So that is called as a cleavage. So cleavage is what? Tendency of a mineral to break along a definite direction yielding a plane surface, that is called as the cleavage. Okay, so the crystals, they will cleave because of some bond between the atoms are not strong as others. Okay, and as a result they will break. So apart from these terms, we also use the basal cleavage, you have seen, right? That is for mica. Then rhombic cleavage of calcite, okay, cubic cleavage of galena and halite. Okay, then we express the cleavage in terms of perfection also, like perfect, distinct, okay, and indistinct. So perfect means when the cleaved surfaces are smooth, okay, when very good breakage is seen, then it is called as perfect. Then distinct means the new surfaces, broken by frequent irregular steps, then it is called as distinct. And indistinct when it is generally rough, with only a few planar areas, which is generally not useful. It is very difficult to distinguish what type of cleavage it is. Then we call it as a indistinct cleavage. So this is regarding the cleavage. Few more example. Okay, so here in the first image I have shown you mica, right? So gypsum. So this gypsum is breaking in this particular direction. Okay, so here if you put a knife there, okay, it is breaking. If you don't put knife also, it will break in that particular direction. So it has one set of cleavage, that is basal cleavage. Even these mica minerals, these all three are micas. Okay, so this and this, okay, they are mica minerals. You can see how it is splitting in the first image, right? It is splitting into layers. Okay, so here it is splitting into layers. You can remove each layer by layer into thin sheets. You can remove, you can see it is layered. Okay, here also you can see there are many layers. Okay, so that form is called as foliated form, which shows layers. Okay, and these are two varieties of mica, which is the first one is muscovite,
and this one is biotite, that is black color. Okay, so and this muscovite will be colorless. Okay, it looks silver because it is piled together. Okay, and it looks brown or black. So that is the color of biotite mica. So these are the two varieties of mica, which has again one set of cleavage, that is this one. Along this direction, the mineral will split into layers. Okay, so that is the mica. Then this is the calcite. Okay, wherein you can see it has the rhombic cleavage. Okay, rhombic. Each smaller piece also it will break into rhombic because it will have the rhombic cleavages. Then this is a feldspar. Okay, wherein you can see there are lines like this. Okay, in this particular direction, that is one set of cleavage. Then there are fine lines which are perpendicular to that. That is a one more set of cleavage. So that is the cleavage of feldspar, perpendicular to each other, two set of cleavages. Then halite, cubic. Okay, each mineral have cube like. Okay, it will break into cubic fashion, then it is called as cubic cleavage. Okay, then there is one more property called fracture. So this is also related to breaking. Okay, so let us understand what is the difference between the cleavage and fracture. So fracture is what? The minerals that do not break along the cleavage line, but they seem to have some pattern in their breaking, that is called as the fracture. So when a mineral breaks in a direction other than cleavage, because if the mineral is breaking along the cleavage, what will happen? It will break, giving smooth surfaces. But here what we are observing is the breaking of a mineral in a direction other than cleavage, how it breaks, that is called as the fracture. So again, there are different terms which will describe the fracture as what is the pattern of breaking of a mineral other than cleavage, that is called as fracture. So here conchoidal, hackly, fibrous, splintery, even uneven, these are the some types of fractures. So I'll show you with the photographs, you will understand in a better way. So these are the types of fractures. So the first one is conchoidal fracture. So here you can see this mineral is breaking like this with a curved surface, right? How the glass breaks, you might have seen the breaking of a glass, it will break in a conchoidal fashion. Okay, then hackly means it will give very jagged, irregular surfaces. So you especially the native minerals or native metals, they show this type of fracture. Okay, they break with a very jagged and sharp edges, that is called as the hackly fracture. Okay, then next we have splintery. Splintery means sharp pointed fibers. Splintery or fibrous. Okay, these are the two types of fractures which are shown by fibrous minerals. Okay, so fibrous is like this, asbestos, fiber like. So when it breaks, okay, it gives very pointed, sharp pointed fibers. Okay, here also you can see the mineral is kyanite. Okay, kyanite will break into this fashion. Even the asbestos shows splintery, that is sharp pointed fibers, when it is breaking in a plane other than cleavage. Okay, then this mica, okay, it is breaking along the cleavage plane, it will give smooth surface, you can see. Okay, this surface is smooth, but when it breaks other than cleavage in this direction, then it will break with a uneven surface. Then if it breaks with smooth surface, then it is called as even fracture. So these are the some varieties of fracture. Example, conchoidal, the example is quartz. Okay, then we have hackly
fracture, that is shown by native metals. Okay, you very sharp pointed edges. Okay, that is very jagged and irregular. That is called as Hackley. So, example, native copper, native silver. In the image, I have given example of a native silver. Okay, then splintery is very sharp pointed fibers. Okay, so that is asbestos and kyanite is the example. Okay, then even and uneven, if it is breaking with a smooth or irregular surfaces. Okay. So these are the that is the difference between the fracture and cleavage. Okay, thank you.